Thank you. well today is to be approved to introduce the Minister of Finance. And as Brian mentioned, we all need to help address our last year's conference. Things have changed a lot in the meantime. We are now from this meeting mandate. We have to British investor. And I think it would be important just to take a moment to congratulate the Minister and his team in foreign affairs and abroad for the work that they have done. I know that they have had Minister personally over 100 visits to the EU member states, to the EU institutions, and outside the EU to interested parties to put across the message that Ireland is still very much at the core of the EU and will be the core of the EU 27. So it is a great pleasure for me to know the Prime Minister to address the summit.
Giving proof that there is life after politics, but I don't know what my own time after politics and says never in these events. But I want to wish you well for future endeavours. I know that everybody here has a busy afternoon in terms of your marking the launch of the latest Brexit status of the report. And I want to, Jill, commend you on. Fellow members of the Institute, in particular those who have made a contribution to this current report, but also to acknowledge your efforts through seminars and meetings and engagements and discourse and panel events over a long number of years, ensuring that you continue to build on your expertise in EU affairs. As an Institute, are perfectly placed to draw on sources whose opinions and views and perspectives we need to hear at what is a critical point on our journey, and indeed a journey that presents challenges of an unprecedented nature, not only in terms of political, but also diplomatic and indeed economic. This is a huge challenge for all of us to rely on the contribution and ongoing engagement. I believe this is a journey that we are all on together, now more than ever. We need to listen, we need to engage with one another, we need to ensure that we exchange the differing views and the differing perspectives in order to ensure that we in government secure the best outcome for Ireland and its citizens. So I believe strongly that everybody, be it industry, academia, government, individual citizen, has their own part to play in addressing the challenges of Brexit. Indeed, for my own part here today, I wish just briefly to provide you with a status update of my own, indeed a reflection on the last 12 months of the government's work, and the assessment of where we stand as we prepare to engage in the matter of the historic negotiations that lie ahead and will shortly. Often said that the past is a foreign country. And certainly, when I look back to this time last year, as has been mentioned earlier, the geopolitical landscape in Europe and beyond had a most different feel. At that stage, we hoped, and we said so. kind of faced with what we in Ireland, that was a compelling case, would vote to remain as active members of the European Union. 12 months ago when I last stood before you, it was to address your conference, theme on that occasion being Brexit a risky business. Then we were 35 days out from the referendum. Our thoughts and perspectives were markedly different than they are today. Then I spoke to you about the strength of a union of 28 member states, about our ability as 28 to be greater than the sum of our parts, to be better equipped as 28 to face a multitude of challenges and threats, not least those that don't respect borders, climate change or global terrorism, and to deliver better results for our citizens as a consequence. The atrocities, of course, that we witnessed in Manchester earlier this week, which I know shocked us all, yet again underlines the need for solidarity with our friends and neighbours, and to continue to work together to face down the threat of international terrorism. So it seems timely then that we are back a year later to take stock of where things now stand. And it seems even more appropriate that the occasion is the launch of this piece of detail in the work. And I commend all those involved. So what has changed over the last 12 months? Well, on the surface, quite a great deal. First, since the referendum result, Brexit has quite simply been everywhere. No longer the preserve of civil servants, think tanks. Indeed, Brexit has worked its way firmly into our national discourse. There's hardly a radio programme that doesn't make reference to it in some way or other. I would say the same for TV and the mass media. As a minister, I meet people on a weekly basis in a wide variety of settings, in rooms like this, at a myriad of events in my constituency, and of course abroad in my capacity as Minister for Foreign Affairs. And I have to say that I find here in Ireland, Irish citizens are most actively engaged, and I very much welcome that engagement. We've all got to grips with the obscure articles of EU legislation. We are now familiar with the roles and responsibilities of the EU institutions as we embark upon the negotiation process. And secondly, over the course of the year, we have seen a marked change at political and official level in the United Kingdom. The Conservative government, which had been riding high in the electoral spoils of 2015, has changed quite significantly over the past 12 months. The referendum precipitated a change of seismic degree, a change of prime minister, a reshuffle of cabinet, and we now await the outcome of the next election in June for further indications as to where public feeling in the UK sits in these times of great turbulence. After months of speculation, Article 50 was finally invoked end of March. Broadly constructive in tone, the government welcomed in particular the references to Ireland in the British Prime Minister's letter of notification, which also sets out the objective of protecting the peace process and avoiding a return to what was described as a hard border on the island. So while we wait for negotiations proper to begin after the election, across Whitehall, the UK is readying itself for the next phase, where it will need to deliver on the decision of the British people in last year's referendum, which will see the UK embark on what will be a fundamentally different course to the one they navigated over the past 44 years as an active and influential and oftentimes constructive member of the European Union. And thirdly then, what of the Union itself? Here too we've seen change, but it's change of a different nature and order. Here I think it's more appropriate to talk about a change in gear, a step up of efforts to come together rather than a fundamental change in direction. At EU level there has been a concerted focus on preparing for the negotiations in a unified manner. EU27 will speak with one voice, and I think largely that has been quite successful. We've had the negotiating guidelines agreed by the European Council in April, the more detailed negotiating directives agreed by the General Affairs Council in Brussels on Monday last, and of course, not to be overlooked, the European Parliament's resolution on Brexit, which was endorsed by an overwhelming majority of MEPs in early April of this year. This work has been complemented by the appointment of key personnel, including former Commissioner Barnier as chief negotiator for the European Union. While I'll return to the detail of the negotiations in a moment, I'd like to note that from an Irish perspective today, we find ourselves very much at the heart of an alliance of 27 member states, negotiating from a position of strength to protect and promote the interests of Ireland and all our citizens, and indeed of the citizens of the European Union. So crucially, at EU level, there has been also emphasis on renewal, the process of renewal. I have to say again, as many of us here in this room have said both publicly and within our own endeavours, that the result, the decision of the British people to withdraw from the European Union was a shock. It was a profound one here in Ireland, but right across the European Union. But in response, rather than abandon the values which underpin our union, it must be argued, and I would argue strongly, that we are instead witnessing a reaffirmation and a strengthened commitment to those values. Quite simply, since the referendum result, we've seen the emphasis shift towards a growing determination among the remaining 27 member states to make a success of the European Union of 27. I look at the Bratislava Declaration of August last year, to the Rome Declaration in March of this year, marking the 60th anniversary of the foundation of the European Union, and we have seen a renewed confidence, a renewed level of conviction in the European project and in the values that it continues to represent, and I believe that's important. I also cite the election victory of President Macron in France earlier this month, further demonstrating that the pro-European message remains relevant and that that message resonates with the electorate. This pro-EU sentiment is replicated in public opinion elsewhere in the European Union, not least here in Ireland, where support for the European Union and our continued membership of that union remains not particularly high, but extremely high. I think that's very important in the context of where we're going. And of course, as a practicing politician of many years standing, let me acknowledge fully that polls don't always tell the full story. But they do give a good indication in broad terms, and they are certainly useful tools to identify trends over periods of time. A politician, I'm always asked about opinion polls. We say we don't comment on polls because the real poll is in the ballot box. All of you have heard that time again. But can I tell you, in the privacy of this room, a good poll is always better than a bad poll. So I said, the polls here have shown us consistently is that since the referendum result in the UK, support for continued Irish membership of the European Union remains strong and high. And ultimately, I believe that this reflects the pragmatism of the Irish people. We know that while the EU is a force for good in our daily lives, of course the European Union is, like any human organisation, imperfect. And I want to acknowledge that the work of the European institutions, it's interesting to note when we were at the border with Commissioner Barnier last week, people were a little bit concerned about the footwear of Commissioner Barnier as he embarked upon a walk across a field of Frisian cows. People said, be careful. What about the Commissioner? Mind his shoes. Be careful he doesn't fall. And Commissioner Barnier turns around quickly and says, hold on. He says, I'm not a Brussels technocrat. I'm a farmer. Son. And I think it's important that we realise that the European institutions, all of these institutions, are made up of people just like ourselves. And I want to acknowledge the presence here of one of those, my colleague, former MEP, Aaron Doyle, who no doubt in the course of the afternoon will let us know what exactly the thinking is in the European Parliament. But while the European Union, imperfect as we admit it to be, we need to acknowledge what it has achieved, the huge amount that it has achieved for the people of Europe. And of course, we acknowledge that it still needs to do better, to continue to deliver more for its citizens, and to do so in a way that is effective. But we in Ireland, we should be part of that discussion. The efforts that push us for that improvement will ultimately shape the outcome coming from within the European Union. So in some respects, that's one key point that hasn't changed in the last 12 months, that we in Ireland still believe the EU is greater than the sum of its parts, and that as 27, we are and will continue to be better equipped face the many complex and indeed disparate challenges which today's world presents us with. So over the last 12 months, one side, on the one hand, that period of time has been characterized by a lot of change. Yet on the other hand, from the government's perspective, there has been a consistency of approach to our actions since the 23rd of June last year. Indeed, much of the work we've undertaken in government since the referendum has, dare I say, been somewhat predictable. By that I mean we had developed a plan to respond to a leave outcome, even though we didn't like it, and although we hoped we would never have to use it, when the result became clear on the 24th of June, we were equipped and ready to go. I don't say that in any self-congratulatory way, but on the 24th of June, I spoke to four or five of my foreign ministerial colleagues and had absolutely no difficulty in impressing on them from a very early stage the unique circumstances that we would face here on the island of Ireland. When I spoke to you at last year's conference, work was already underway on the first phase of contingency planning, which was published, of course, on the 24th of June. This work was reinforced by a clear understanding of the priority issues for Ireland in relation to the withdrawal of the UK, namely, to minimise the impact on our trade and the economy, secondly, to protect the peace process and the Good Friday Agreement in particular, maintaining the common travel area with the UK, and to secure Ireland's future in a strong European Union. All of these underpin the most fundamental objective of all, ensuring the continued well-being of our citizens here in Ireland and right across the island. So, while we were deeply disappointed by the referendum result, we were nevertheless ready to roll out our approach in a systematic way towards the next complex phase. This response was characterized by three main features. Firstly, structural changes. Secondly, systematic engagement at home. And thirdly, strategic outreach abroad. Of these three, probably the simplest to implement was the restructure. At political level, Taoiseach established without delay, and indeed still chairs, a dedicated cabinet committee on Brexit, which has met in plenary session 8 times today, and provides political direction to our Brexit strategy. The Department of Taoiseach continues to provide strategic directive to what is an all of government effort to deliver on Ireland's interests and objectives in the negotiation. Responsibility for EU functions returned to my department last November, and staffing in key diplomatic missions in Brussels, in London, in Paris, and in Berlin were reinforced in order to respond to the new requirements and demands. And I'm confident that we now have a framework in place which is fit for purpose to tackle the challenges that lie ahead. Indeed, critically, that structure is flexible and remains under review to allow us to recalibrate resources as required to respond to the evolving needs of the situation. Next, our attention turned to systematic engagement at home with stakeholder groups, indeed with citizens, to deepen our analysis and to move confidently on to the next phase. The All Island Civic Dialogue, which I co-chair with the Taoiseach, was a critical piece of that effort. Over 1,200 delegates, including many of the faces I see in this room, attended and indeed participated in the numerous sectoral dialogues, enabling government to have one of the widest possible conversations on the implications of the withdrawal of the UK for this island, north and south. And in my capacity as Minister for Foreign Affairs and my involvement and instalment at the talks, on every occasion which we had an opportunity, I also had a Brexit-related meeting with community groups in Northern Ireland, with business groups in Northern Ireland, with farmers in Northern I believe that was fundamentally important in the context of our island engagement. Indeed, just last week, my ministerial colleague Joe McHugh hosted a sectoral dialogue event in Letterkenny, which focused particularly on the northwest and the wider border region engagement of stakeholders from a range of sectors in the northwest. So this process of the many sectoral dialogues is ongoing. Extremely useful. With two plenary sessions of the Civic Dialogue in November and February, chaired by Tom Arlen, this process has allowed government to hear the broad range of concerns raised by Brexit across the island for the economy, for society, for the peace process, for North-South cooperation, for human rights. This allowed us at government level to feed these concerns and issues into our preparations for the negotiation. And I'm pleased to see that many of these key questions have been raised, continue to be raised, teased out, and they're also mentioned and addressed in the status report. And so, in many cases, what you have done complements very well the issues which we drew together at government level in our document entitled Ireland and the Negotiations of the UK withdrawal from the European Union, as published earlier this morning. Given the nature of this process, naturally, the specifics of the key negotiating points will only emerge and indeed will only crystallize as the negotiations proceed. So we view our publication as a comprehensive starting point upon which to build the strategy for the negotiations, which we will hope will commence over the next few weeks. Then we have the final piece of the puzzle, which is our strategic outreach. The objective here being to ensure that our partners across the capitals of Europe and within the institutions had a sound and indeed detailed understanding of the unique implications of the withdrawal of the UK from the European Union for Ireland, particularly in relation to Northern Ireland and the peace process, the Good Friday Agreement. To achieve this, after acknowledging the leadership of the Taoiseach, implementing a targeted programme of engagement with our partners. For my own part, I've had over 80 interactions with counterparts from the European Union member states and from the institutions. That began in the morning of the 24th of June, and most recently has involved visits to the border region by Michel Barnier himself, as well as Luxembourg Foreign Minister, and with further visits planned in the weeks ahead. I have an important party vote next Friday. It coincides and clashes with the visit of Danish Foreign Minister Anders Samuelsen, who again at my invitation delighted to accept and is eagerly looking forward to actually seeing the open border and meeting community groups along that border from north and south. And when we talk about the importance to maintain the open border, I believe a field study for people like Michel Barnier and other foreign ministers is essential in their understanding. But I hope I'm back to a time for the border to participate in what will be a very important part of national event as well. But during the process of my engagement, I've been struck by a number of key points. Firstly, I think it's fair to say that there was already a high degree of awareness amongst partners in Europe of the situation on this island, with particular reference to the actual peace process, peace and stability in Ireland, which I've been at pains to say I didn't hear once in the context of the referendum campaign last year. But if you take as I do, the European project being in itself a peace process from the horrors and destructions of war in the 20th century right up to the maintenance of peace and stability right across the continent today. If we look at that at macro level, but then at micro level, we have the peace process on the island of Ireland. And I'm pleased that many of my foreign ministers are proud of the role that the European Union played in the run-up to the Good Friday Agreement, or as I've said numerous occasions, the European Union provided a very convenient umbrella for discourse between Northern Ireland, Dublin and London when things were more difficult and more challenging than they were today. But in the context of my discourse with colleagues across Europe, I have to say when it came to the detail, that there was, you know, obviously and understandably less awareness of the particular provisions and operation of the Good Friday Agreement and its successors, and of course the often fragile nature of politics in Northern Ireland, which again over the past 12 months we've seen direct evidence of the fragile nature of the institutions and indeed the fragile nature of discourse in politics in Northern Ireland. Indeed, for many of my European colleagues, I have to admit that the situation in Northern Ireland was viewed as having been settled. So there was a real and pressing need in many of my meetings to go back to first principles, setting out the nature of the peace settlement on this island, including the unique constitution and political context, the fragile nature of the Dáil institution, and the centrality of our shared open border. In all cases, a vital aspect of our ambitious programme of diplomatic engagement around the European Union has been to underline the very particular legal challenges that the UK's withdrawal will pose and the specific needs that would arise within the context of the forthcoming negotiations. In doing so, we continue to highlight and emphasize the status of the Good Friday Agreement, an international legally binding agreement registered with the United Nations, and the particular responsibility which that requires of Ireland and the UK in respect of our core guarantee. Further matter of national interest is, of course, the avoidance of a hard border on the island of Ireland. As arguably the most important symbol of the peace process, the open border is essential to social and economic well-being on both parts of the island and to the further normalisation of relations following the difficult decades of troubles that I just remember. In addressing the importance of the open border on partners, visits by Commission, Council and Parliament figures to the region have been invaluable, because there's no substitute for seeing, or indeed in the case of the border, for not seeing the border and the indispensability of this for life on the ground. This affords our key interlocutors a proper understanding of why remaining as close as possible to the status quo must be a key political objective of the European Union in the negotiations. As we've said, the avoidance of a hard border will require imagination, that will require creativity, and importantly, this has been specifically recognised and reflected, indeed expressed, in the European Council negotiating guidelines. We know that achieving this objective will not be easy. Compromises will be required on the UK side as on the EU side in order to find a solution that realises the shared objective of avoiding a hard border and one which protects Ireland's obligations, Ireland's interests, Ireland's advantages as a continuing committed member of the European Union. There's an important responsibility also here for political leadership in Northern Ireland. At this critical and challenging time for Northern Ireland, as the UK-EU negotiations about to commence in a matter of weeks, the restoration of a power-sharing executive in Stormont is absolutely essential. People of Northern Ireland voted for a new assembly and a new executive as far back as the 2nd of March. The overdue obligation now on the parties involved is to again work together to deliver effective devolved government for the people of Northern Ireland. But I detect a willingness, a determination by the parties to achieve that, and I look forward to participating in the resumed talks in Belfast as soon as practical after the British general election. My expectation is that the election on the 8th of June, with the results on the 9th, 10th of June, I would expect the following Monday, Tuesday, that we will be back to Belfast around the table, because this clock continues to tick at a pace. So a successful outcome, a new executive, by the 29th of June deadline, is indeed imperative if Northern Ireland is to continue to build on the progress made over the last two decades, to ensure that partnership and reconciliation can be advanced, to deal effectively with the challenges now presented by the withdrawal of the UK from Europe. A new executive is also required in Northern Ireland so that the essential engagement and cooperation with the government through a North-South Ministerial Council can continue across the various sectors, including to address the all-island impact. There's no doubt but that Ireland is a member state most at risk from the withdrawal of the UK. However, we are determined that our interests will be protected, and we've therefore engaged early and in some detail with all of our EU partners. And I think we can be pleased with the return so far on these efforts, and I acknowledge what Jill has said in that regard. At EU level, we've seen the unique issues of Ireland recognised at every key priority document as mentioned earlier. Council guidelines, the detailed negotiating directive, have a strong acknowledgement of Ireland's specific concerns, including on the protection of the gains of the peace process, the Good Friday Agreement, in all of its parts, on avoiding the hard border, maintaining bilateral agreements and arrangements between the UK and Ireland, such as the really important common travel area, which is far more than travel as we know. The directives also recognise the need to address the rights of Irish citizens residing in Northern Ireland and the continued enjoyment of their rights as EU citizens, as well as the recognition of the unique geographic position of Ireland when it comes to addressing issues such as transit, which is crucial for our exports and continued access to the single market. In addition, the European Council also agreed a statement recognising the unique constitutional status of Northern Ireland and the need to ensure that, should a united Ireland be brought about in accordance with the Good Friday Agreement, the entire territory of such a united Ireland would be part of the European Union. So in short, let me make it quite clear that our unique priorities, each and every one of them, have been accepted by our 26 partners as shared priorities of the European Union as we commence the process of reconciliation. That's the past 12 minutes. If I can briefly look to the next 12 minutes, while admitting what I've said only marks the beginning of the process, but it is the right beginning for us. We can choose whatever type of letter for you like, but sticking, I suppose, to the sporting field, in this game of two halves, I'd say we've made a solid start. We've had a good first 15 minutes, the wind behind us. It gives us much to build on going forward and move forward with determination. We will. At EU level, when this meeting of the General Affairs Committee in Brussels signed off on the final details to facilitate the opening of Arctic negotiations, we have a clear idea now of how this process will work, led by Mr. Barnier, under the political oversight of the European Council. And we have an equally clear understanding of the three areas of focus: the issue of citizen rights, the issue of the UK's financial settlement, and the border issue on the island of Ireland. So far, so good. The simplicity of the presentation, however, belies the complexity of the task at hand. Even leaving aside the border, the other two baskets of issues present multiple challenges and complexity. Take briefly the issue of citizen rights. On a positive note, there is clearly political goodwill on both sides to find solutions to this issue, but the detail will be complex. This basket straddles many important issues in the area of residency rights, workers' rights, not to mention aspects of access to education, access to healthcare. But that said, I believe an early agreement in principle on the reciprocal protection of citizen rights is achievable, but must be regarded as being a priority. This would be important for individual EU and UK citizens and their families who find themselves in a position of uncomfortable uncertainty as of now. We should never forget ultimately, this is about the lives of our people, this is about the lives of our citizens, this is about their interests, and this of course must come first. In addition, a quick agreement in principle on this issue would also be important for building confidence between both parties at an early stage in what would be a difficult set of negotiations. Let's remember, it's in everybody's interest. These negotiations start well and are carried out in a constructive and orderly manner. The financial settlement question, detail is no less critical. I don't view it as helpful for Martin commentary and meeting who's like what over a dinner in Downing. But let's not forget that there's a general election underway across the world. But I will say this, that the British government has always accepted that they will need to honour certain obligations and that they will need to honour certain liabilities as a departing member state. As part of the exit arrangements, this is already a matter of public record, and it's one that, to my mind, should be addressed in an orderly and constructive way. This is not about punishing the United Kingdom. This is not about issuing a bill for leave. But it's very simple. It's very simple. A legitimate expectation on the part of the European Union that the UK should honour any financial commitments for which it has already entered into. This issue will be addressed in the course of the negotiations, and it's not dispute. But the handling is going to be key here. So rather than focusing on figures which can be unnecessary, inflammatory, I think the Commission's approach to the negotiations is a smart one. Let's look at the methodology first. Let's agree the principles first. Then let's calculate a figure based on the agreed methodology. More than anything else, the endless commentary on the bill in the meeting underscores the highly political nature. It also brings into focus the link between the exit negotiations and the future relationship negotiations. We know that on the British side, they're keen to get into the details of the future relationship they will have with the European Union. We understand this perspective. But equally, we support the view of EU 27 that we cannot rush into this second stage. In accordance with the framework provided by Article 50, progress must advance on the exit issue before we can turn to the future relationship. I think we should remain hopeful that with pragmatism and goodwill on both sides, we will see a sufficient measure of progress across the Arctic. scoping out the framework for the future relationship between the UK and the EU. All going well, I would hope that this will happen by the end of this year. Can I say that it comes as no surprise to anyone in this room that the future EU-UK relationship is of enormous concern and indeed enormous interest to the Irish government. We know that Brexit will disproportionately large impact on our economy. We've been very clear that we wish to see the closest possible trading relationship between the EU and the UK after Brexit. Achieving this would be of utmost importance to strive to mitigate the impacts on our economy. But for this reason, our focus in government is intensified on the economic damage of Brexit. Work is underway on a further piece of detailed analysis to examine the economic implications, including identifying domestic policy measures to protect our economy from the potential negative impacts of Brexit, to reinforce the competitiveness of the Irish economy, and to pursue all opportunities that might arrive. Therefore, I noted with great interest the chapters of your status report which look at the agri-food sector and separately the role of SMEs, quite rightly identified these as being on the front line in terms of the impacts of Brexit on the Irish economy. The questions that this analysis, yours included, throws up are complicated or challenging. But if the last year has taught us anything, we must avoid or rush to simplistic answers which you presented as catch-all solutions. We must continue to invest time. We must continue to invest effort in research, detailed analysis and planning. So I look forward to feeding your work into the consideration of key issues which is underway at the heart of government. So let me say by way of concluding my work, brings me neatly back to the point that I made at the very beginning. That is that there is a clear role for all of us today in shaping Ireland's response to the profound and historic challenges posed by the withdrawal of our nearest neighbour and ally from the European Union for 44 years. We have many months, maybe many years ahead of us. But I believe we should step forward together on the back of the solid work undertaken today, ready to respond to the challenges before us, ready to deliver the best for our people, for our citizens, for Ireland, and indeed for the European Union as a whole. So I want to wish you every success at your conference this afternoon, and I want once again to acknowledge the very important role played by the Institute in the public affairs of Ireland and the public affairs of the European Union, and I wish you continued success.
That I have in London certain this was often too much of a ground with entity. But I don't think, excuse me, we should be under any disillusion that it isn't going to be difficult. It's going to be very difficult to find solutions to these diametrically opposed positions between the EU and the United Kingdom. Our session now will be in two parts, as you know. The first part is a bit more political, the second part is a little bit more dealing with specific economic issues, although some economic issues are really dealt with in the first session. So I'd ask the speakers for the first session. Thank you. Our first speaker is Brendan Halligan. Brendan is a co-founder of the Institute for International and European Affairs, and I can tell you he has been the driver of the Institute for at least 25 years. Brendan, very welcome.
Thank you, Chairman. My first duty, like everybody else's, is to thank Kevin and Cheryl for hosting this event. This is the second time we've collaborated on this. On Brexit. I particularly want to thank Brian Monroe. I have a relationship with Barry which is similar to that of the minister who's just spoken. I know we're going to have to work with both of our fathers, in the case of Barry and the board of the woman, Barry General. And of course, the minister's father, our dear friend and comrade, colleague, Mr. Pettis. Might you give me a given the occasion? Where we are, both here in Campbell's Hill, and acknowledging in particular the presence of John Temple Lang, professor, that we have associated with this institution a long time ago, and the presence of Mr. Justice Adam Penley, who recently of the Supreme Court, of course, previously of the Court of Justice. But his great claim to fame is that he and I studied together in UCD, where we did economics and law. I have to thank the Minister for his continuing support. And just make two points. That's, he talked about the renewal of the EU, which is a point that I think we should reflect on. And the fact that Ireland will play a role, he used his expression, as soon as the referendum result is in. Now, this is a status report, that's how it's so described. It's dated May of this year. It follows the first status report, which was dated January. So what it's doing is it's looking at the intervening developments. Now it's a combination of facts and interpretation. Interpretation may not always be the right interpretation, but it's what a think tank does. And this is our attempt to interpret the facts that we have seen in one fully front of us. The opening chapter, which I drafted, sets the scene. And I have 5 points to make in that chapter. The first is that the EU has a roadmap for these negotiations now. Secondly, there is profound difference in terms of the procedures to be followed throughout the negotiation between the EU and the United Kingdom. There was a question of so whether or not the first phase will even get past Christmas, or the first one. On the assumption that it does, then we enter a completely different set of negotiations from March 2019. start with the withdrawal agreement. The European Union approach, I think, has been characterized by the fact that it is formal, highly formal, and highly structured. You heard the minister talking about the most recent decision of the General Affairs Council. It's highly formal and structured because preeminence has been given to the treaties. That's a self-evident to some of you most here, but it's something that Biden can't afford. We don't even so, absolute preeminence of the treaties and strict adherence to the text of the treaties. In order to ensure a couple of things, first of all, the treaties determine the order and the content of the negotiations. Secondly, they lay down the limits within which the EU negotiators must operate and beyond which they may not stray. A point I hope has going to be understood very clearly and openly. Next, they give legal certainty to the outcome, which will be absolutely crucial from the point of view of the last point. This is imparting political legitimacy to the agreements that come out of here. In a sense, the ultra vires rule has been invoked. Here are the treaties, you can't stay beyond it. And I call the court, which has just decided such a distinguished member, in looking at any piece of immediately to look at the beginning where the text will invoke the articles of the treaty upon which it is based. In regards to the structure, we see that the United Kingdom approach is quite different and less structured and less formal. It is based on a series of speeches and letters. Obviously, the letter to the House speech is the most important of these, followed by a white paper, which by being called a white paper is essentially a repetition of the speech. It's an addition of the white paper in the speech was displayed back to the House. And then of course the rather long Article 50 article which we addressed to President Tusk is really a big deal to almost verbatim places. The conclusion to be drawn in the current study of these documents from the United Kingdom is that the United Kingdom knows what it does not want, it doesn't really know what it does want. And this is a problem for Westerners. So you cannot say that it has a clear roadmap. In particular, you might summarize it by saying that it does not know, the United Kingdom does not know how to reconcile the contradictions between rejecting the single market, rejecting the customs union, rejecting a role of the ECJ and rejecting any budgetary responsibilities with its stated objective of having frictionless and effortless access to the single market and frictionless borders. At the same time, without having an agreement on dispute resolution mechanisms. That was my first point. Second point is that I think it's been clear from the very beginning, this is a point that we've made in various documents that we've published during the course of the last 4 months, that there's a clash, a fundamental clash between the two approaches. The EU, in compliance with its treaties, has adopted, or is committed to, now legally committed to, as you heard from the minister, a sequential negotiating process. So, in a very structured fashion, and in fact, Darren Hagan said it's important for us to do things in the right order. It's a very French and Cartesian approach. But it's more than that, is it actually complying with the treaties. On the other hand, the United Kingdom wants simultaneous negotiations to go on. And Mrs. May, in her various letters and speeches, constantly uses the word alongside of the resolutions of the negotiations, whatever it is they are, to go alongside each other. And as we know, the structure now agreed and given to Barnier as a display of instructions are that we will commence the withdrawal agreement and deal with in phase one deal with three issues, which the Minister has mentioned. The most contentious of which clearly is going to be the single financial settlement. The Minister has offered some elements of optimism about a resolution of that matter. David Davis specifically rejected the concept that the British government owe anything to the European Union's dealing. There is the problem. Because it's only by sufficient progress, and that's the word we use in the negotiating directives, have been achieved, and that will be a decision by the European Council, that the Union is then going to be in a position to proceed to the next stage of the negotiations, which is going to deal with the framework and with the future relationship and also the transition arrangements. So, if we're on the meet the 2-year deadline, as prescribed by Article 50, that is only in relation to the withdrawal agreement, then we're going to have to get the first phase concluded by the end of this year. As to whether that could happen or not is a moot point. In the stated report, we say that the odds of failure are 30%. As Mr. Davies and others have pronounced, some commentators, including myself, have increased those odds to 50%. And have sharpened the time frame within which failure would occur. That is the great threat that this may cause the cliff edge. I do recall also our continuous statements, including in the letter to us, which is to say that no deal is better than that. This is constantly repeated in the position. So, by Christmas, I think, certainly. Now, that leads us on then to the framework. As you recall, Article 50 is a peculiarly worded. The author of the article claims that he did this on the Friday evening at his kitchen table, almost as an afterthought, something that had to go into the report of the convention on a new constitution of the EU, which of course was abandoned as a project. But that particular article was carried over all its goals into the treaty. Now, what does this framework mean? It's a political sort of agreement in terms of principle on what the relationship might look like. And then, if that is agreed, we then move on to conclude in the number of the details or our friends. So, after the end of 2 years, negotiation, which will include, of course, ratification in the European Parliament and by the European Council, and could conceivably include ratification by national parliaments, would then proceed to the new relationship. So the timelines are going to be very tight, and I suppose they're not going to be succeeded completely, but not as a good point. New relationship, which we discussed in outline in this second phase of the negotiations, has got the tricky problems that we mentioned earlier, and that is to say, how do we deal with the desire to be part of the single market at the same time as not being part of the single market? How do we deal with the customs union when the United Kingdom doesn't want to be part of it, but wants to be part of it? Mrs. May has talked about possible association, associate membership of the customs union. And she says that my mind is open on this, and I more or less accept ideas on the matter, but nobody has one of them. It's a critical one, ultimately, for us, is of course the fact that it's going to be very, very difficult on the activities, which really is what's driving. So, lastly, I want to say that from the point of view of Ireland, it's very obvious, as Vincent said, there's no need to repeat all of what Vincent has said, is that we were ready to go on day one of this, and that the Irish government's position has been very carefully worked out from the very beginning, and I think has been extraordinarily successful in this presentation to other member states, and the fact that it has been included, as he said, as a part of the 27 member states. It's been very strategically intelligent in the sense that it has focused really on two issues, the travel area and the multiplied area. It has not gone beyond that. What surely is going to happen in the next phase is that there is which we know have been cleverly analysed, and of course they are not that very encouraging. Now, the status report deals with this kind of terrific chapters by John Bradley, John Gray, and by Thomas Gerald, all of which are extremely well worth while reading. Last point is a sort of a PS mentioned by Donny McKay, a point that he raised last weekend. And that is to say that while one can take a particular view of the United Kingdom's negotiating approach, structure, and as I said, is much less formal than the European Union's, by reason of what the European Union is, nonetheless, it has changed significantly by Mrs. May calling the election and by publishing a manifesto in which Blackness and House did a speech and White Paper basically repeated. And that confers a constitutional status on our negotiating position that was previously lacking. And Donnie made the point that once a government is elected on a manifesto of the British Constitution as a written convention, that that's it. You don't contest it. And hence, it will not be attacked by the House of Lords. So once she has a majority and she said this is what I've been elected on, then she has got the constitutional legitimacy of pursuing that. That's not necessarily good news, of course. And the other point that I'm asking, since it's occurred since we wrote this, and the Minister referred to it, as being a corresponding sea change on the European Union side politically. And that is the election of President Macron, but also the results in the North Ireland and West Australia elections, which clearly indicate that Mrs. Merkel is going to be returned. So we're looking at Franco-German alliance, back in a position that has not been in for 5-6 years, in terms of driving the whole EU project forward. Both of them are going to be in power for 5 years. This is great, offers them for great political certainty to the European Union. And I think it's going to provide a new impetus and a new authority to the European Union. So I thought, why not have it? I just have one personal comment to make, which is that I've said, I've repeated very often Eric and Cheryl's contention that membership of the European Union, both this and 72, would be psychological liberation for Ireland. I think that Brexit is a culmination of that process. I think it's this is the point at which the political power between Ireland and the United Kingdom will go. And I think it provides us with astonishing opportunities for the future. Have a look at Barry Desmond's, Barry Andrews, Barry Andrews' closing remarks, includes this state of support. He's done a word count a number of times at opportunity to use the state of support. It's quite astonishing.
Thank you very much, Brendan. And I'll ask Barry Andrews to say a few words. Barry is the newly appointed Director General of the IRDA.
Predecessor, he wrote his chapter, he couldn't be with us today. So I'm happy to stand in, and in fact, I think my political career has a bit of a reputation of being able to stand in at short notice for various events and to extemporize the subjects, given a very short period of time to prepare. And one particular occasion, I was asked to speak with a delegation who came into Leinster House, and what I taught on a subject called breastfeeding in 20 minutes' time. So I said, well, I sat down, scribbled a few notes, I gave the speech, sat down to a very thin round of applause after my remarks, and said to my host, was that okay? He said, yeah, it was very interesting, although we did ask you to speak about press freedom. Only largely. I want to start by thanking the campaign. time out of politics. I'm going to the movies and hanging out with the children, fixing up the garden, painting the fence. It's fantastic. He said, it's funny, I asked somebody that question about 6 years ago, but more or less the same response. I said, well, who was that? Charlie Flanagan. So he went on to return to the Dáil and become such a success as Minister of Foreign Affairs, and I want to thank you most particularly. So my comments will be brief. Tom provides an excellent summary of the island of Ireland and the issues arising there. I wish to make 2 points, broadly speaking. I was at a talk yesterday where Mark Shanahan, head of the IBA, couldn't convey more strongly the idea that he wants everybody in that room to amplify the message of Ireland's commitment to EU membership. We might think in a certain circles that we all mix in that is something that is really, we can take for granted, that's priced in, we understand that to be the case, but in the circles that Martin mixes in, I'm sure our diplomats mix in, that is not something that should be taken for granted whatsoever. And we saw a television program on RTE during the week, which probably wasn't that helpful. So he was trying to emphasize that idea of Ireland's commitment to EU membership. And there was a publication earlier this week by the European Council of Foreign Relations about Euro coalitions. And what it tried to explore is the idea of, in the large European Union, 28 member states, where are the binds of affinity within that membership? There are the original six, there are the Nordics, the Baltics, there are peripheral countries. Do they have informal coalitions? And is this a good thing? Because a lot of people are meet. If it is a good thing, these informal coalitions allow consensus to build up ahead of major votes, major decisions, and contribute to the coherence and cohesion of the European Union in general. So this publication earlier this week examined these coalitions through a survey that it did of public policymakers, the likes of the people in this room here, across the European Union 28. And what was interesting is that Ireland doesn't belong to any category that was set out by the Council of Foreign Relations. So there's the original six, there's an affluent seven, there's the Nordics, there's the Baltics. Ireland doesn't feature in any of the categorizations. An interesting snapshot just to think about. But when you go into the depth of the report, you find that when the people surveyed were asked, which is the country you go to first when you want to form an alliance on something such as foreign and development policy, Ireland ranks number one. Which is the country that is most committed to deeper integration in Europe? Ireland ranks number one. So there's certainly alliances there that we need to tap into. That are a huge potential for us. And one of the key things we want to do in the Institute of International European Affairs now is to try and think about that and turn our attention to our EU27 group that is beginning to develop an agenda for itself. And to try and think about like-minded states, to try and think about themes, to try and think about regional alliances. And some of the members of that group are here today. I think it's a critical issue. So, for example, on the digital single market, we are members of the Digital North, the D9 as it's called, which features Benelux, Baltic states, Nordic states, and they are countries that are committed to the idea of accelerating the development of the digital single market. So that's a key alliance that's going to be critical for Ireland to be a part of. Because we all know that the UK and Ireland, for all of our history, there's a massive political, cultural, and affinity, and that's going to leave a huge gap for Ireland in the future. So it's trying to figure out how do we exercise our influence. And it's clear in the first part, as the Minister described, the first 15 minutes of this game, that we've had an outstanding effort. And we have been so excellent at exercising our influence. And I see it in my previous job when we see the work that David Donoghue did as the co-chair on Sustainable Development Goals, the influence that Ireland exercises on that. That he co-chaired for Ireland the Migration Summit, and Ireland's influence is excellent. So I'm confident that we can begin to develop those new alliances. I'm confident that work that we do in the Institute can contribute to the development of policy ideas under those headings. The second point I wish to make is on just to pick up what Brendan said about opportunity. I don't want to be Pollyanna about this. This is an existential threat, but the question is, wasted a good crisis in this country before. And if you read the chapter that John Bradley has written of the ESRI, and formerly of the ESRI, has written. He's written a whole chapter on opportunity. And what he says is that, look, we went through the 60s and 70s, where we had to emerge into a free market situation post-Whitaker, and the context of our European Union member, our EEC membership in the 70s. We went through a period of churn when we became members of the Europe Single European Market after 1992. And John concludes that Brexit is probably more manageable than those changes. Well, whatever your own views of that, the point is that this is a crisis, yes, but let's not waste the crisis. And he concludes by saying, this is the opportunity for us to complete the modernization of our SME sector. So it's a very interesting, different perspective in circumstances where there is quite a lot of gloom about around where things are going. There is, throughout the status report today, references to the opportunities that lie ahead for us. And Boris White, formerly of the IDA, writes about those opportunities, which Martin Shanahan amplified again yesterday, in terms of if the European Union sticks to its negotiation guidelines in relation to making sure that any free trade agreement that emerges does not allow any state aid advantages or regulations advantages for the UK. That is a very positive thing for Ireland's position in terms of attracting investment that we've been so successful with over recent times. And you'll hear from John McGrane in the next session, who will identify some of the opportunities for the SME sector, and they are real opportunities. So I think it's an interesting issue that emerges from this status report. But this status report is the latest in a series. I just want to just reflect on this as a final point. Barry Devereux mentioned the point earlier that there was a discussion here in May of 2016, where we had a discussion, the Institute had a discussion around Brexit. And that was based to some extent on the work that Dahil Kelly and the UK Policy Group had done throughout 2015 and 2016. And there was a publication in 2015 by the Institute, which was virtually clairvoyant in terms of setting the scene, issuing the warnings, and imagining the ground that we're about to embark upon. And we had our first status report then in January of 2017. This is the second status report, and we have already begun our plans for the third status report, which will be, I think, a lot more focused on the granular issues as we move out of the speculation period, as we move from generalization into specialization. We begin to look at those issues in more detail. So finally, for the island of Ireland, for the politics, and I'm sorry Blair Horan isn't speaking here today because he makes a very, very interesting contribution in his own piece. And he has identified a key problem in the North, which is the lack of discussion that is going around about all these issues. I've had a discussion with an individual who's trying to set up the equivalent of the Institute of International European Affairs in Belfast. Every issue has its root in constitution, has constitutional implications in the North. And as a result of that, it's immediately polarizing. As you all know, in North Ireland, it's a very difficult layer of experience of that. Through the unions, we've heard it from the Ulster Farmers Union, they cannot take position on any of the key issues because of the constitutional implications for any strong position that the North may take. So there is a role for us as an institute to support the capacity for creating a forum for discussion in the North in the coming years. So with that, thank you for your attention. I'll hand back to you.
Just a microcosm of the problem with Northern Ireland. So output per head which has done miserably in Northern Ireland since the Belfast Agreement, is going to be badly hit by Brexit. So the second aspect is a concern that the Northern Ireland depends on major transfers from London, and the rise of English nationalism, it could see those transfers being cut, which could be politically destabilising. So that's one channel that we are concerned about. The second is trade, and it's what most people focus on. And the first thing to say is that all research done in the United Kingdom suggests that Brexit will be seriously negative to the United Kingdom, reducing in the long term GDP by somewhere between 0 and 8%. The harder the Brexit, the bigger the number. It's a very uncertain area, but it is going to be seriously negative. So as a market for Irish exports, it's going to be much less favourable. In terms of trade and our exports, and Colin will be talking about, and how in particular food and SMEs exporting into Britain will be particularly badly affected. It's firms that don't have market power. There are many firms in Ireland that have market power that export to Britain who will not face a problem. And Lipitor, the only place it's made in the world, is in Ireland. If the NHS wants to buy Lipitor, then buy it at whatever price, and the Irish or the multinational sells it for. They won't face a problem. So when you look at the exports, 15%, 18% of Irish exports went to Britain, it is the food, it is the SMEs, it is the Irish-owned sector that is going to be more affected. The SRI did a paper which suggested that the effect, trade effects of Brexit could lead to a 4% fall in Irish GDP. Now, I don't like putting a number on it. I would much rather say it's a range. It is going to be seriously negative, but that was their number. The next channel is foreign direct investment, and we have heard a lot of talk about this area, how it would be affected by the inflow of, some investment by the financial sector in London moving to Dublin, Frankfurt, Paris, or wherever. And that is definitely going to be a positive effect on the economy, and constrained, of course, by the availability of housing. If you look at the cranes, the office space probably isn't there. And however, longer term, it's not just financial sector. People concentrate on that. There's another paper by the ESRI looking at long term. The reason why foreign firms have invested in the United Kingdom is they want access to the European market. And in particular, for example, Japan. Japanese firms are very important to Europe. And where did they pick? They picked the United Kingdom. The problem was they didn't pick the United Kingdom to sell into the United Kingdom. They to sell to Europe. And they are going to have to relocate. And this is going to be a long-term process. You don't close the factory in 2019. It is when the factory needs to be rebuilt, you decide where it's going to be. So over the next 10 or 15 years, you are going to see Japanese firms, Indian firms. Cameron went to India, was it 4 years ago, looking for Indian investment, and they said, no, we're not going to invest. We want to invest in Europe. And until you can guarantee us we'll be in Europe, we're not going to invest. Actually, Theresa May went in September and got an even stronger reply. So that when you're looking at foreign investment in Europe, they want the European market. And another paper by the ESRI put a number, once again a single number, of +3 the effect on Ireland, which would roughly cancel out the -4. But there are positive opportunities, as John Bradley emphasises, through that channel. Another channel which has been less discussed is logistics and distribution. In this mercantilist world, certainly the world of Trump, people talk about, imports are bad. Well, actually, the problem for us is that far more of our imports come from Britain, and that may be cause more dislocation in this economy than the problems for our exports, even. Because it will be impossible to manage the distribution sector and the supply chain. And for example, Marks and Spencer's, Tesco's. If Marks and Spencer's, if all their goods come from warehouse in the United Kingdom, they will have to be separately cleared through customs. Even if there are no tariffs on things made in Britain, nothing that Marks and Spencer's has made in Britain. It's made in Sri Lanka, it's made in Thailand, it's made in Vietnam, and they will be subject to European duties. So there's going to be substantial dislocation there, and it is going to raise costs for everybody in Ireland and make us less competitive. That is a negative plan. And the way you deal with that is you hope that new retailers will come, maybe Leclerc, Carrefour, others who will bring competition to the Irish market. So delivering our imports in a competitive way into this economy is important. And remember, our imports from Britain are much bigger than our exports to Britain. And the other aspect, of course, is logistics. An awful lot of our imports come through the United Kingdom in lorries. Will we be able to clear them through without facing it? Will there be a special Irish channel where you can just drive through? And if you're from Britain, will it be stopped in Irish? Unless we have that, it's going to be a major problem for Irish farmers. And it was interesting that Mr. Safin, the French Minister for Finance, when he was in Dublin last month, particularly picked up on that issue, that he was understood Ireland's concerns. But there's a very particular concern, of course, for Donegal. That Donegal, everything in shops in Donegal comes through the United Kingdom to get there, comes through Northern Ireland. So this issue of logistics and how we deal with the issues is going to be crucially important to minimise disruption. And that's where no agreement could be exceptionally disruptive. And the labour market is another area, but it looks to, in terms of the research done, that that is manageable with goodwill on the British part. There isn't an EU problem on managing the labour market and free movement of Irish people working in Britain or British people working here, providing there is goodwill and there appears to be. So that may not be a problem. Another channel is the financial sector, and it's received a lot of attention. Sterling has weakened and may well weaken again because of Brexit. However, that's a temporary effect in terms of, yes, buying in Belfast is much cheaper today than buying in Dublin. But you're seeing higher inflation in Britain, and eventually exchange rate changes are working themselves out. In the short term, it's very disruptive for firms, but in terms of looking at the longer term effects in Ireland, that's going to be less important than the FDI or trade or Northern Ireland effects. There are a range of other channels which I'm not going to go through, some positive, some negative, like the single electricity market. If Europe can import electrons of electricity through wires which carry red, white, and blue Russian flags on them without problems, I don't see why electrons coming from Northern Ireland with Union Jacks on them shouldn't enter the wires for the public. So one can get carried away on some of the areas where there are unlikely to be problems. To sum up, overall, it seems likely that Brexit will be negative for the Irish economy. You could put a range of maybe -8 at the worst, 90, but it could also be, there's a small chance it could be positive, +1, something in a wide range. But my best guess, it is going to be negative. The final thing is, it is going to play out over a very long time scale. And in some cases, positive, like the influx of financial sector firms, will begin before 2019. The effects of the trade disruptions will come in 2019, the negative effects. And the long-term beneficial effects of an inflow of foreign direct investment will play out over a 15-year period. So it's going to be a bumpy ride. It is likely to be negative, but it is something which we are the administration is working on managing. Thank you.
Ireland's farming and food sector is particularly vulnerable to the Brexit scenario. For, I suppose, three main reasons. One is the high dependence on the UK market. Secondly, because some of the products we produce, notably milk and beef, enjoy a very high level of import tariff, import protection under the EU common customs tariff. And thirdly, of course, there's the land border with Northern Ireland. Now, other contributors to the status report deal with their environment issues, so I'm not going to go into that. I should also mention, of course, that the agri food sector has already felt the first round effect of Brexit in terms of the depreciation of sterling, which was very quick and very significant and has took the system very quickly. Just as regards the UK market, basically the UK imports about 48% of its total food needs, and 60% of that comes from other EU countries, including Ireland. Now, the UK is Ireland's largest agri-food export market. It's worth over 4 billion a year, 37% of our total exports, and it's particularly important for beef, dairy products, certainly prepared foods, but also did subspecialist food areas or subspecialist products, such as mushrooms. I just look very briefly at beef and dairy products. UK imports about 35% of its beef requirements, and Ireland supplies 70% of this. So we're a very big player in the UK market. Now, if the UK market is to lose its value, the scope for switching those exports to mainland Europe is very limited, mainly because the market is well supplied, and like a small extra producer can actually destabilize the market very significantly. So there's a problem. At farm level, I should mention that beef production is a low income sector, and farmers in beef production are very, very dependent on the CAP direct payments. On dairy products, something like over 50% of our cheese goes to the UK, but it's over 80% in the case of cheddar cheese. And again, it's very much an Irish UK product, so there isn't really an easy alternative available. But UK is also important for butter exports, for example. Now, I just want to very briefly look at three particular issues, I suppose, for the sector that strike me. One is the customs union. The second is where does WTO vision on this? And the third is the EU budget. So briefly, as regards to customs union, the customs union, including the common customs tariff, is actually the cornerstone of the common agricultural policy. And the current price levels that farmers in Europe enjoy depend very strongly on that level of import protection. And as I say, this might be widely shouted from the hilltops, but like the level of import tariff for beef going into Europe is about 60%. For dairy products, it's probably 50% or a bit higher, and they are our two dominant production sectors. Now, we know that the UK wants to negotiate new trade agreements with third countries, and they said to leave that, they were not to do that. They were either going to leave the customs union or negotiate some new customs agreement with the EU. And of course, we also know historically that before Britain joined the EU, they operated what's called the cheap food policy. In other words, they sourced their supplies from around the world, not from the former Commonwealth, and you were supporting the farmers direct payments. On the other hand, of course, Europe is offering to negotiate new trade agreements with the UK. So now it refers to a level playing field being required to achieve that. So I think that the agri-food sector is pretty concerned, and I would be concerned about maybe the absence of any dialogue so far or any indications coming out from Brussels about the future of the customs union as things stand. And the problem actually is that if Britain is allowed to have a liberal import regime, the value of the UK food market is severely undervalued and is really no longer profitable, or would be no longer profitable to send product in there. Of course, it also raises the question of border controls. And I mean, that's a big issue. And such rule things as rules of origin, which is referred to the publication, become very important. On WTO, I mean, it's there in the background. Global trade is governed by the rules of WTO, with limits on import tariffs, domestic support, and things like health and safety standards. Now, the first thing I think that has to happen as part, I presume as part of the exit process, is that, like at the moment, the UK's WTO commitments are linked in with those of the EU 28. So the first thing that has to happen is to unbundle those. And I mean, that would be, you know, a job for each job myself. And New Zealand Lamb is probably the best known case in point there. I presume sometime, somewhere down the road, if there isn't an EU UK trade deal, WTO rules would eventually come into play. But again, the WTO is an organization that moves very slowly, and has very good membership. To move our attention to the EU budget, the UK's net contribution annually is 10.5 billion euro. Now, the Common Agricultural Policy takes about 40% of the budget, and in Ireland's case, about 90% of transfers from Brussels to Ireland now are in the under the cap. Cap trade payments on average for all farms make up about 65% of farm income. That varies from below maybe 35% on dairy farms. Somewhere must be 100% for beef, lamb, and probably cereals as well. They were also aware that these coherence reports coming back that there is resistance from the net contributing member states to increase their contribution to the budget in the future. So that theory is a big twist in itself. So basically, then to conclude, first of all, I think that the major issues for the agri-food sector really come under the heading of the future trade negotiations towards phase two. Clearly, the North American bond ratio is at this stage, at least in phase one, and we'll see what happens there. And we have read terms like flexible and magic solutions, but you know, it's a good time to tell, I suppose. I think this is widely reviewed that by the end of March 2019, there will be little, if any, progress made on details of a new trade agreement. So in that situation, I think the transition arrangement does seem to be pretty inevitable. Having said that, I think that, you know, because we do want to know what the final destination is, the transition arrangement, to my view, probably might get a little bit more than roll over a lot of the existing arrangements for a period of time, which obviously would be helpful in its own right. And then I should say also that, you know, sterling exchange rate is the environment, but I think clearly it is very vulnerable to a hard Brexit outcome. So, Chairman, that's what we got to conclude on that. For those who want, I'm retired from my paper now, but for those who want, if you do want to read more about the agri-food sector, IFA have published a detailed document there in March, and that's on the website. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Con. We're running off a little bit against time, so what we do is we take questions until about 3:25, and then we give you a 5-minute break, and John Coleman, our office chair, will share his thing. So, would like to go across. No questions at all? Any comments? Please. And then you tell us who you are.
Yes. I'm the Slovak ambassador here in Ireland, and let me try to break the ice a little bit. Question I'd like to ask Professor Fitzgerald about the programs upcoming for specifically the airport industry, I mean, air transportation industries and the airlines. The bosses of the airlines are very vocal about the risks and disruptions of Brexit. And I would also ask this question in more political context. It is very complex and complicated to explain to most of the normal citizens the impacts of Brexit, but if they one day wake up and they won't be able to fly to Portugal or from London, that might kind of like give a new dynamic of the stance of the public opinion in this regard. So if you could maybe elaborate on the risks of a cliff edge for the air transportation industry and possibly the political impacts of it. Thank you very much.
I think it would be so disruptive if under current arrangements, airlines from any country can fly to or from any country. There will need to be some arrangement with the United Kingdom when they leave and what's going to happen. But it seems to me if flights between Britain and Europe were to end in March 2019, that would be nobody's interest. So yes, theoretically, it's a possibility. I know Ryanair raised it, but I just think that
Michael Hamilton, Adjunct Professor of Agriculture in UCD. I was going to ask a question about what happens if Labour wins in the UK. Polls may change. My big question is, I've heard nothing here about the work that the EU itself will have to do to reorganise all its trade deals. And I worked in that area for quite some time. There is an immense amount of work on every international agreement that the EU has. I take the New Zealand lamb example, but it's a small one, but I take it because I work on it. And that is, the EU will have to divide out the 250,000 tons of lamb that comes into the EU and say, X amount of that was for the United Kingdom, the rest of it was for Europe. And that is a huge extra piece of work that hasn't been mentioned here at all, but will have to be done. So I ask the panel, what do you think in terms of transition? And it's not just transition for the UK, it's transition for the EU with all the countries with which it has agreements.
Colin, would you like to start off?
Well, I think, like you probably was, a lot more about the light of the practicalities. But I mean, I refer to the fact that for a start, that the UK's commitments in WTO have to be taken out. I think there's a big one for high quality beef in a whole range of mainly Latin American countries as well. And I mean, the problem that I understand is that, well, one problem is that their parties' budgets within Europe will have to, shall we say, we have an interest. For example, I mean, France, take that as an example. France won't want its market oversupplied in the new alternative arrangement. So that'll be a problem. Equally, I mean, there are something like 164 countries in WTO. And I mean, my mind is very peripheral, but I got there to decide by consensus. So they move very, very slowly. So I mean, I think the broad picture like this is right, that that's an issue that is, I say, immensely complicated and hasn't really been aired very much at all. And as I said, I think, I mean, in my interpretation, it should be part of phase one. But I feel the issues in phase one, like the three that were mentioned here, are small big, that something like that seems to maybe be kicked forward into phase two. But, like, I mean, probably only the House of Members of Brussels know the answer to that.
I would suspect that there are people in the position who are thinking about it. I would suspect.
Dahlia, I can possibly give you a flavour of that. Jack Golden, I was at on a delegation to Brussels a number of weeks ago with the European Chamber of Commerce in Ireland, and one of the meetings we had was with DG Agriculture, where we got a slight insight into this. They said they've had 200 people working on this topic since around the time of the Brexit vote. So I think it's the preparations are well underway.
Glad to hear that, Joe. Any other questions? Yes, please.
Will you stand in the Institute? Just two comments or questions. Thank you, Simon. Firstly, on Brendan Hannigan's remarks about this is made very hard on Conservative manifesto on Brexit. But I take Alice Lawrence's point in that she wins, that it's more difficult to amend it. But in one sense, she can't say anything else. You know, I mean, that is her negotiating position. And it's a counterpart of this. Do you think, and Italy or British, maybe some British commentators are saying, do the continental, European continental political leaders, the Commission and so on, and Mr. Barnier understand that the depth of feeling in Britain on this issue? Or do they think it's all going to be all right today? So there's that point about this is made. And the second point I'd like to make is to ask you, generally about it. It is general. If the economic consequences of this, obviously for Ireland, are high, because they're going to be high if it turns out negative for anyone, do you think that there can be a sort of a 10-year fudge of this, that Britain will have to get some sort of settlement where it can say we are out of various things in the market, court. But in fact, they're in them as far as they can go. And similarly, from the continental point of view, EU 27 point of view, there will have to be some disadvantage shown because if there's a break. But when will we come to that stage where the economic sort of scenarios of total breakdown become so adverse that you may get things economic lines, as I said, emerging?
Brendan, would you like to try?
I have to preface my remarks by saying that while I also passed the economics exams, but I did so on the basis of Willie Scally's notes. But his notes are as always the man like this. So he's my master and teacher. I'm hoping that eventually. I speak as a complimentary Willie. I think you raised a very important point that's not really emerged as yet, and that is the time frame for all of this to happen. Roughly speaking, we're going to have a period of 10 years, which you properly referred, broken up into 2 years, 3 years, and 2 + 3 + 5, maybe 10 years in all. So 2 years on the divorce, 3 years on the new arrangement, and 5 years implementation, and which I should say we'll have a three-year transition, and then a 5-year implementation period. It's interesting that the terminology that the EU side focuses very much on the transitional regime, or was a bridge between the UK leaving the European Union and then devising new relationship with it under the treaties of Article 2A, and then the implementation of that agreement. It was said very wisely. Think about what's happening as a reverse to accession. This is the accession. But accession required in every case, and as we know in our case, it required a long period of implementation. Now, what you're asking is, during that, particularly during this second 5-year period, can we devise a situation in which the United Kingdom is and is not simultaneously a member of the European Union? In the book that we published in Europe, The Endgame, which has been referred to earlier, we talked about a bespoke solution for Britain. It doesn't exist. We don't even know what the legal basis of it is. But you're making the point that if the economics of this are clearly pointing in one direction, then there will be a clinical imperative to deal with it, in which case legal solutions have to be found. And I think the answer to that is yes. And the point, the last contribution by Jack there, about the amount of work that's been done in the Commission, well, those of us who are familiar with European institutions can be absolutely sure of is there are a couple of hundred people beavering away on what these folks might look like. And I think it's essential for us to get that over, but it has to be these folks. And there's no doubt in my mind, and Tom has been graphic about the impact of agri business, there's no doubt in my mind whatsoever that we are going to need a special regime to handle the implementation period. And the only analogy that I can apply can think of is, well, there are two analogies. First is Jack Lynch in 1979 on us agreeing to join the European monetary system. We did so on the basis of soft loans being supplied by France and Germany, as we call. And then of course there was Robert Reynolds agreement to enter the EMU, which of course gave rise to the Cohesion Funds and all the other rest. We are going to need something on the economic front. On grounds of solidarity. Well, I offer this caveat. Solidarity is a two-way street. And we've got to show solidarity, especially in areas where we are not currently showing solidarity. The most obvious of which, of course, is defence and security. Of course, comfortable with the future. I might just add, if I may, add something to that. I think implicit in what you said really was that as the negotiations proceed, there may come a period when the British see the deal as being so bad for them that they might reconsider. My personal belief is that there is a deep antipathy in Middle England to the European Union, and that's been there from the beginning. I don't think they were, as a country, fully committed to membership of the ECC. There were various deals done time after time after time to take account of not British, but English views. And I really think that the decision which was made was much more emotional, much more cultural than it had to do with economics. So I really feel very deeply that the possibility of the English people rethinking their position on membership of the EU, even in the event of the United Kingdom splitting up, and there is a much greater chance now that Scotland will go independent than there was 2 or 3 years ago. Even if that were to happen, the views of some of the English friends that I met over the last 2 weeks, but so be it, the costing is a lot of money. And I think that's very deeply the English side. On that note, I give you 5 minutes.